Welcome back to Labeled, the stories, rumors, and legends of Tooth & Nail Records. I'm your host, Matt Carter, and today is just a continuation of the story of Haste the Day. So make sure you've listened to the last episode with Jimmy Ryan, who was not a Tooth & Nail kid, but nonetheless found his way into the scene, built a legendary solid-state band, and then walked away from a dream and left a giant hole and provided the opportunity for a Tooth & Nail kid, if there ever was one, the multi-talented Stephen Keech, to walk into a fairy tale dream come true scenario and knock it out of the park, taking Haste the Day to new levels. So very cool two-parter here. And if you hadn't subscribed to the new Labeled feed, Deep Dives, please do that right now. The last episode we did, number 3 in that series, was with Aaron and Spencer from Under Oath, and it was a pretty special conversation that I was quite happy to be a part of. So please check that out. Okay, here's me and Keech. Well, so I want to know, based on, like, you know, as we're setting this conversation up with that flexibility of character of yours, is that something that is, you know, fundamental to your personality? How do you wind up getting to this point to come in as a frontman? And how are you different than other frontmans that makes this special transition of frontman work? I mean, that's the thing I'm most curious to just explore across the conversation. But I'm curious, all the way from a young age, like in your character, fundamentally, how you think. What's different about you that enables all this?
Well, first, I don't know if you know much about Enneagram, but I'm an Enneagram 9. So I'm a, they call that the peacemaker. I need everyone to get along. And, you know, if I were somebody who, you know, was trying to be above everybody else, then that's not getting along to me. I need all of us to be having fun. So, so it's just not really I don't have a super competitive nature.
Is that true as a kid, like in sports, not trying to win at sports? I self-identify kind of in the same way that you do, but people don't think that about me, but I feel that way on the inside, and I'm notoriously not competitive at sports. I just am happy to lose as long as everybody's having a good time.
Yeah, same. I mean, I played sports growing up, but I was never, I'm a driven person, but I've never been like one to like, I don't know. I'm not gonna jump over you to catch the ball. You know, I might take a step back so somebody else can do it. So it doesn't make me the best at sports, but that's totally fine with me. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing is some frontmen, some singers, they are there to perform. They're there, you know, which is great. And to be like a really, really good performer, you kind of have to have a little bit of that, like, you know, I'm special, I'm important kind of attitude. But I personally have always loved the music. Like, the music is the thing that got me into this. I love songwriting. I love getting together with people and playing. And I love the studio. The studio is like my favorite place in the world. And so I think because that was my main drive, the performance thing was just kind of another thing that I had to do. Although I loved it, it was really fun. It was just another thing that I had to do to be a part of the music, right? Mm-hmm. That was my, so I had to be good at that and I had to like that. But at the same time, I didn't want to, I don't know, I was more about the band. I was more about writing songs and playing music together.
So that kind of, in a musical context, that really is a little bit more like composer and conductor is more of that, sure, role than necessarily performer, basically. Yeah. And I don't think there's a shortage of people like that, but it is striking that you could have a pathway on top of that. You can sing, scream, perform, be a front man, lead a group. Like, that's the surprising part, really, is that part is on, you know what I mean? That you obviously seem more like a composer, conductor, and identify that way. So what is the path that lands you as Jimmy Ryan's replacement in Haste? How does that happen?
Oh, man. So this story is pretty fun. So I started a band when I was 14. We were called New Day Awakening. We were in the Denver area, kind of the suburbs, up in Westminster, Broomfield area.
Don't see bottom limbs that fall down. Too far from me, walk will bring me to my knees.
And we started you know, playing a ton of shows and started getting a little bit of notoriety towards the end of high school. And I had met a guy named Jason Anderson who used to play drums for Squad 5-0. He played a little bit for 238. And he was just kind of the cornerstone of the Denver scene at the time. He was recording all the bands. He was a part of booking shows and all that stuff. So he, you know, he got us connected with this promotion company called Soda Jerk in Denver. Mm-hmm. And they...
Is that Mike at Soda Jerk?
Yeah. So there was... Yeah, I was trying to remember their names. But yeah, Mike was at Soda Jerk. And, you know, they were the big players. They did. They brought all the bands that we wanted to see. They brought all the bands that we wanted to play with. So we got in with them, and Haste the Day came to Denver all the time. So we, of course, we loved Haste the Day. We were like, when Everything Falls came out, I remember listening to that in my parents' basement with the rest of the guys in the band. We were like, oh my gosh, this is exactly what we're going for. Like, we want to do this.
And were
like,
you the singer of that, the band that you were in?
Yeah. So okay. I started the band playing guitar and singing, and eventually we went from kind of emo to just metal. And we got our buddy to come in and play guitar, and I just went straight to vocals.
So you were the, but you were the, when you started that band, you did start it as primary songwriter and frontman? Yeah. Like, okay. So,
yeah, so like at the very beginning, it would just be me writing songs in my basement, and my friends would come over and we'd be like, all right. And they'd be like, what are we playing today? Like, yeah, I've got this new song that I've been working on. Here's the guitar part. Here's the bass part. Here's the drum. And then of course they would change it and make it our own. Eventually it became more of a group effort, as we kind of shifted into like metal. But it was, you know, I still had a pretty heavy hand in the songwriting.
And you're kind of just a full stack creator though. I mean, you even do, can you draw and do graphic design if you needed to?
I did graphic design a little bit when I was younger, but it's really complicated.
Yeah.
But and I could draw, I guess, but I'm not like great at it. But yeah, I do, I guess I'm more on the artistic side of things than maybe analytical.
It's a kind of a polymath kind of a thing, like, you know, it's cross domain type of stuff, obviously. Yeah. But anyway, that's a, you know, so it seems like in anything in the creative thing, you can have the confidence somehow to even become, you know, I can write the song and sing the song and arrange the other people. You know, that's a seems like a confidence. Is confidence a word that describes you? Not insecure. I don't know. What is it?
I mean, I struggle with all the same insecurities that everybody has, you know. I guess I just loved it so much that I could get past some of those and just go for it. You know, I mean, I was still, even to this day, I mean, music is my job still, and I'm putting stuff out all the time. And I'm, you know, I still get nervous, you know. I'm like, what are they going to think about it, you know?
One more probing background question, but yeah. Is supportive parents part of that for you?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Okay.
My parents, so I come from a musical family. They're okay. Awesome. Like, you know, I've grown up playing on the worship team. My parents led worship for a long time. And they're pastors as well. So, they were totally cool with me going the music route. I showed at a really young age that I was really interested in music and, just, you know, when I was about 10 years old, I got serious about like playing guitar, and I didn't really want to play guitar to riff. I wanted to play guitar so I could write songs. It was just kind of what I wanted to do. So, and they were very supportive of that. Even in the screaming, you know, awesome, yelling phases, it might not have been their favorite music, but they went to all the shows.
So it wasn't even inherently rebellious what you were doing.
Nope. Not
and,
really.
And then you wind up joining a, you know, we're back, almost back to that story where you join a band full of very dutiful Christian young men.
Yeah.
So it was supportive. It wasn't rebellious really. At, you know what I mean? It just sounds this holistic kind of like your family. You're doing what you love. You've known at an early age. It's just, you know, it's an idyllic kind of story.
Yeah. It was definitely a dream come true situation. I So anyway, we got connected with Soda Jerk. We begged to be on the Haste the Day shows. And so we played one show with Haste the Day. And that was amazing. It was like our, you know, favorite show probably so far. Then we played another show with them, maybe 4 months later or so. I found out later that they called, Mark LaFay called, or somebody called Soda Jerk to make sure that New Day Awakening was on the bill. Mm. And they're like, oh yeah, yeah, they're on the bill again. They're like, okay, cool. I found out later why, but, you know, we played the show and it was like, it was really fun. And I remember that night, like, I remember feeling like I needed to say something. Like, we always said something about Jesus, on stage, but I remember that night I needed to say something more. Like, I felt like I needed to say something. Yeah. I was like, I just had this like conviction that I needed to talk more about Jesus and mm-hmm. like say something. Like, I don't even remember what I said. But I even felt afterwards, I was like, man, maybe I should have dialed it back a little bit. But months later, they called me, cause they had gotten my phone number that night, and they called me and they asked me to fill in, for Jimmy. And, it was a European tour with the Juliana Theory. And they said that one thing that stuck out to them was how much I talked about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was one of those, you know, odd, I don't know. I don't think we can call them coincidences right now, but anyway, they asked me to come play and I told them no. I got a call from Jason and he was like, I remember I was in a Barnes and Noble with a bunch of my friends and I look at my phone, it says Jason from Haste Today. And I was like, what? We're going to get signed and go on tour. This is going to be amazing.
Yeah,
so I answer it and he's like, hey, we're looking for somebody to fill in for Jimmy. And right at that time that tour was like, we were booking, New Day Awakening was booking our first like tour. We decided we were going to quit our jobs, quit everything. And these are like my best friends, you know?
Yeah, if you get to quit your job with your band level, that's the final level before you're all that way in. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. So we were like, that's deep loyalty and commitment. Quitting jobs and like going for it, you know. So and so I had this, you know, I was busy. I was booked. And I was like, sorry, I can't. And they were like, are you sure? And I was like, yeah, I can't bail on my friends. I'm sorry. And so I hang up the phone and I tell my other friends, none of them who I was with were in the band, but they were like, are you kidding? You just got like the call that everyone dreams about. And you just said no, like, are you stupid? And I ended up calling Jason back and be like, hey, could I get some more information?
How
about
long
that
after, too? How when you call back, how long later?
It was probably an hour. It was an hour. And I asked a little bit more information and,
it could have easily been filled. The position could have easily been filled in that 1 hour.
Yes.
Cause I've been absolutely. In that situation where you're trying to get a bass player or something. You're like, okay, well, here's 10 people I can call.
Yeah.
To, you know, and then you keep moving down that list. So it could have lost it in the hour.
Well, I still didn't say yes. And they, I dragged them along for about a month and, I got a call, from a guy named Mark LaFay, as you guys talked about in, previous episode. And Mark is, at least at the time, I mean, I was 19 years old, at the time I heard that actually at that time I was 18 years old still. Mark was not for me joining the band. I was not his idea, you know, to him, I was some new 18-year-old kid who, you know, who knows if he's going to be able to deliver, mm-hmm. you know, a singer of some local band that Like, and I think in his mind, what if I have like some serious lead singer syndrome and come in and act all cocky or whatever?
Mm-hmm. This sucks. I'm already going to have to do a Mark LaFay bonus episode just already. It's just,
yes, I already have to do that.
I understand that now, but go on ahead.
I mean, he's, there's so many stories.
I know.
And so, anyway, so he calls me and he like, oh, he was so intimidating and scary. And I'm picturing this dude in a suit, you know, he was, to me, a band manager is like the man, right? Mm-hmm. Like it's a really intimidating business person. And you know, he kind of intimidated me. He's like, are you ready to leave your family and all your friends and move to Indiana and be in this band? Because if you're not ready, then we don't even want you. Like, and I don't ever remember. It was something really intense like that. And, yeah. So he like scared the crap out of me. And, I was like, I'm not ready to do that. That's why I haven't told you yes yet. but I'll let you know. And I remember I was working at Chili's at the time. And finally I had enough of Chili's and I was in the to-go area and I wasn't supposed to be on my cell phone, but I got on there anyway. I called Mark LaFay. I said, hey man, I'll do it. And I went straight to my manager and I was like, Steve, I'm going to Europe for a month and I don't think I'm coming back. And he was like, okay.
Awesome.
So
yeah, that's a big moment. You got to live a dream moment. That's hilarious.
Yeah.
And, totally. I mean, Chili's makes it sound like he wrote it for a TV show too.
I know. Oh man. Yeah. Being working at Chili's, man, that was a thing.
You finished that shift and that was it?
I finished that shift. No, I think I did my 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Because the tour didn't start for another month or so. But that, I mean, that tour was with the Juliana Theory, who was like my favorite band. And like, I mean, that was just mind blowing. So my two favorite bands, Haste the Day and the Juliana Theory, on a tour in Europe. I had never been to Europe, never even thought I'd go there. So
I mean, it's hard to think of, if you think of people who have achieved, you know, great things, how easily it would be that they would not have. For instance, if you didn't have the parents you had, you know, you just don't have the chances you have for things to work out the way they do, including just your friends not talking to you at Barnes & Noble. I mean, it's easy to see how, you know, it just things wouldn't happen at all. It's weird when you go back, especially on these stories like this. It's like it could have gone wrong at every single place or else all of these things would not have happened.
Right.
So I guess that's what makes storytelling interesting, is only the hindsight that makes it seem crazy.
Yeah. When you look into the past and you see all the pieces just lining up. I mean, even my dad, so like, talk about supportive parents. He was one of the main factors why I said yes. I mean, he asked me, he's like, what are you waiting for? Like, what's going to make you say yes?
Wow.
And he's like, this is what you want, right? You want to be in a signed band, like touring and
that's not a typical dad. Even a typical supportive dad doesn't go that far. That's kind of a pretty amazing dad move.
He did his touring days. He was in a gospel group called The Sound.
Cool.
You know, rock and roll. But yeah, so he was the one who like, you know, finally changed my mind. I was like, man, he's like, your friends are going to forgive you. Like they would all do the same thing. And it's true. I mean, later on, like Dave Creasel ended up joining Haste the Day, who was the guitar player in New Day Awakening. And I'm still best friends with all of those dudes in that band. And
it wasn't an immediate problem with them. They weren't even like, were they stoked out of the gate?
I mean, I can't say that they were thrilled about the idea, but they also, every one of them were like, well, I mean, I would do it. So you should do it. But it's still, you know, it sucked for a little while, but we overcame those obstacles.
That's great. That's great to hear that even that didn't become too negative. So that gives us a good opportunity to ask your favorite songs in the catalog, because it does sound like something of a Tooth and Nail kid. By F 18, your favorite bands are Juliana Theory and Haste the Day. Then you are, in fact, a Tooth and Nail kid.
I was full-blown a Tooth and Nail kid. And you asked me this question, what are my three favorite songs? And this is a very hard question to answer. But I feel like my answers are good. So the first one I'm going to say is Savannah by Zayo.
Yeah, favorite Zayo song. Probably in my top three moments in the catalog.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I mean, I remember when Liberate came out and my sister listened to it. So one of the reasons why I got so into all this music is my sister, she's 5 years older than I am. She was super cool, man. She loved all the Tooth and Nail stuff. And, you know, you'd be hearing all kinds of like crazy stuff from her room all the time. Zayo was one of them. And I was like, I remember... You know, because MXPX was like my jam, and somehow MXPX didn't end up on this list, even though they were like my favorite band.
You said that about all of them. They're all your favorite bands. Okay.
Yes. I mean, they were like favorites at different times, right? Like, the Juliana Theory was like, you know, early high school, and MXPX was like probably late elementary school, I guess. Anyway. So I remember listening to Savannah for the first time, and I was like, this is so scary.
Scary, yeah.
Yeah, and it was like, it was probably the first, like, real metal band that I heard that was, like, screaming and doing all that, and I just couldn't get enough of it. I was like, it's so scary, but it's so cool.
Yeah, that's big.
So that's a good one. And then, of course, Juliana Theory, If I Told You This Was Killing Me, Would You Stop? Watch your mouth. That was the first song. So I tried to start bands a lot when I was like in, you know, middle school through high school. And so the first try, I got these dudes from church together who could barely play their instruments. And we tried to play that song.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we got maybe through the first verse. And we never got past that. But and then the band dissolved. But yeah, that song is killer. And then, man, I just love 238 and This Town Will Eat You.
When you surround yourself with lunatics and crack addicts, and when you find yourself falling down on the inside, I will not be surprised.
That I listen to that on repeat all the time, just all through high school. Just, man, I love that song.
Yeah, those are classic ones. I mean, we're in this right in the same. I'm older than you, but my musical development happened in the exact parallel same time. When I was getting into that same music was the same time that you were. I just was older, you know, in my life when I discovered it. I didn't have those things when I was 16, 17, 18, not even 19 years old, really. But we were probably in our 20s, probably even discovered that, you know, that kind of thing. But that's cool to hear, right in line.
Yeah.
So let's then think about what we're looping right out of Jimmy's story as you intersect here. And you're joining, right, what we're just going to go ahead and talk about the transition there to how it fitted, especially spiritually. And we kind of painted the Haste of Day guys as youth group kids or whatever, a little bit, maybe a little bit of a caricature. But nonetheless, you know, you come right into that and we're even selected for that spiritual, you know, component. So tell me about creating a new culture and how Haste of Day and those characters in that band evolved, you know, from your point of view from there.
Yeah, so, when I joined the band, it was four.
Well, let's make sure to jump and make sure we talk about each album, you know, as we go too, so we can drop in some music and stuff there too. But
so when I joined the band, it was definitely like a ministry first, which was awesome. That was the culture that I had come from in my old band. That was what we wanted to do as well. And so we kind of viewed everything through that lens of like ministry first. And, you know, so we definitely didn't drink. We didn't like, we were terrified of girls, or I had to stay away from girls. I was the only single one like throughout the band for a long time. They all had serious girlfriends, and I was just single. But yeah. And we just didn't even cuss. You know, we had a cuss jar.
You had a cuss jar
in the van. Yeah. I mean, no, it was very pure.
Wow. I mean, this is after two records of them touring and they still have a cuss jar in the van.
Cuss jar.
I mean, that's pretty extreme. I mean, because, you know, bands, like, everybody starts with something kind of like that, but usually it gets rounded off at least a little more quickly than that.
Yeah. And eventually a lot of those, like, you know, hard lines got a little blurred maybe throughout the days. Not that we ever, like, did anything crazy, but... as members changed, so like we did Pressure the Hinges, and that was me. I feel like every record was like a different, like another change of lineup.
So let's talk about the first record that you were on, which was Pressure the Hinges. Yeah. Okay. Yes. So that's the first one you were on, 2007. And who's the lineup? So you joined in 2006.
Yep.
You filled in, and then how did it became permanent? You go to make a studio record.
Yep. So by the end of that year, we went to Vancouver and did a record with Garth Richardson again.
With Garth. That's still all original Haste Today personnel otherwise.
Yep.
Jason, other than Jimmy, everybody still.
So, okay. Yep. So we got Jason, Brennan, Mike, Devin, and me. And so, oh man, that was a great time. Jimmy was talking about how awesome Vancouver is and how rad it is to work with Garth. And I mean, I couldn't agree more. It was incredible.
He's done a lot of good records for Tooth and Nail, you know, and everybody has different stories about Garth, you know.
Oh, but, man, he was so mean, and it was awesome. Yeah. I mean, he was awesome. Like, not it was just the first time I ever experienced, like, a producer, right? Uh-huh. So you go in there, and we were trying to do this mix between screaming and singing, like this, like... I'm trying to remember the band that we were like referencing, but just like a scream with a tone kind of thing. And we were trying to accomplish this. And I remember going in there and trying it out for the first time. And Garth has a stutter. And he was just like, you sound like a drunken idiot. And I was like, oh, okay. Let me try something else. And I think we ended up just like doing a layer of screaming and a layer of singing on top of it. But he was just so honest and brutal. It was awesome. But his vocal production was just unmatched, like especially in that genre. It was just, he was so good at capturing that vocal.
What about the writing of that? How did that come together writing-wise with you coming in? Because they were a riff, they write the riffs and work them up and then do the vocals last. So I'm guessing, but or did you get involved even in that part?
Yeah, so it was Jason wrote a lot of the riffs on that album, and he'd bring it to the band, we'd all play it. But I was at all the like writing set. I would have like a little microphone and just scream gibberish, you know, trying to come up with rhythms and all that stuff.
So that integrated pretty well right away, the co-writing.
Yeah, and cool. I got to write, I think, three songs on that album. And so that was, like, really exciting for me. I got to write some stuff and bring it to the group.
So, what song from there do you think holds up the most today and is, you know, the one that you like the most? I know Pressure the Hinges has the most Spotify. No, it doesn't. The Stitches has the most Spotify plays.
Yeah. Yeah. So Stitches was like our single. And that I think we were kind of playing around with doing some more singing and less screaming, so that I think Stitches is a great song, but it felt off brand slightly.
Because it was more singing?
Yeah. And
but
I
it
think
worked. I mean, that's one people are listening worked. To today.
Yeah.
So that's like a big transition moment in Haste Today history to go from Jimmy Ryan to sing the singing. It feels off to you, but it, you know, that's
yeah,
that's
it's
a big
just
moment.
Funny when I think it struggled. It's funny that it's actually got more plays. I guess in my mind I didn't think that. So maybe my whole thought process is wrong.
Well, that's what we have the ability of hindsight here to look and say, well, the behavior today is that's what people are choosing. That's the one that's what they're choosing. So interesting, at least.
Yeah, totally. I think my favorite is, or the favorite of the one, the three that I wrote was the Minor Prophets. That was, I think, the one that I was trying to do that sing screamy thing in. And
that's the one with the one story about Garth. Said you're drunk and idiot on that song.
Yeah, I think it was that one.
What line? Do you remember what line?
I don't remember. Okay. It was probably any of those. There's like some singing on top of screaming, any of those lines. Yeah.
Well, how do you remember then turning this into the label and the label accepting you and the fans? Like now that, you know, you've got with the band, you've done this, you've made a record that's good. At least you knew it was good at the time. And then now it's time for fans and label to respond. How did that go?
Yeah. So this is kind of a funny, funny thing. Cause I think I want to say that while we were doing this, Under Oath had maybe just come out with Define the Great Line. And so, you know, I'm paying close attention to Under Oath because they also went through like a singer change.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a success story for them. And I was like, okay, I'm doing this now. I don't want to ruin my favorite band. But when Define the Great Line came out, Spencer's vocals were like lower. And I was like, crap, that's what I do lower vocals. Like, are people going to compare us? Which no one has ever compared us ever, because his voice is just insanely great and awesome. But I do remember, like, that was an anxiety for me. Like, I was like, there are so many anxieties about coming in and having such big shoes to fill.
Yeah.
And trying not to ruin your favorite band and like being on your dream label and hoping that they like you as this replacement, you know? And, it was scary. And I do remember releasing, I can't remember which song we released first. I think we released Pressure the Hinges first. But I remember going on MySpace and reading the comments, which
ooh, scary.
That's not a good thing to do.
Yeah.
And man, kids were mean, dude. Yeah. I mean, not all of them, obviously, but like there were some mean kids out there, and they were like, you know, still, you know, it hurts a little
what,
bit.
What, you know? What can you, what is, what were the ones that hurt the most said what?
Oh, I mean, Stephen ruined the band. Haste the Day is over, you know, just those little things that just like stuck with me. Although, you know, the thing that I needed to remember was that, you know, Jimmy stepped down and I was asked to be in the band. So I couldn't have ruined the band because I didn't like force my way in there.
Yeah.
So, that's just unrealistic to think about, but yeah, it was a really scary thing, but overall it was just so exciting. And watching those first week numbers, like, you know, and I think in Jimmy's episode, you guys talked about the first week numbers and how exciting it is to just watch as they go up. I don't know if that probably isn't the same anymore because of streaming and all that stuff, but It was very exciting. It was cool.
And the numbers came out good on that. So, you know, that was, I don't know what the numbers were. If you remember them, feel free to say. But that that 2007 time, third record, you know, that's to make it past the sophomore slump and then into the third record and continue to be growing. And fortunately, the music industry was still on track reasonably at that time. So, but it was, the label did feel, and I'm asking, I don't know the answer to that, but the label did feel that it was successful and that the band was on track at that point once you got the first week numbers.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
That's great.
I think that's the biggest Haste the Day record.
And it sold the most of any. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense and is really a cool part of the story. And so you'd already been playing live and stuff like that. So were the live audiences already were accepting?
Yes. Yeah, for the most part. I do remember a really funny situation where I would fumble my words with like pit calls and stuff sometimes. And there is this girl standing in the very center of the stage, just like looking up at me. And I messed something up. I was like, I want to see the biggest place this pit has ever seen. And like totally messed up the line. And I was kind of cracking up. And this girl, she did a thumbs up sign and turned her thumbs up upside down to me. Like, and she had this like big frown on her face. Like, you suck. I wish I could meet that girl and shake her hand. Cause that was one of my favorite moments.
That's a very powerful nonverbal heckle.
Yeah. It was awesome.
That's cool. So at this point, it's off and running. You were getting some big tours. And I mean, it seemed like Haste Today was just on, totally on track, crushing it. So you must have had some of the biggest tours and experiences in 2007 and 8 then?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
And you're single. Swear jar.
With a swear jar. No drinking at this point.
And playing what kind of shows? Like, what are the biggest opportunities and things you were getting?
Let's see. The second tour I did was with Bleeding Through and Every Time I Die and Between the Bear and Me. That was pretty huge for me, personally. And let's see. I'm trying to remember. It wasn't until later we did, I think our biggest club tour was like Saints and Sinners tour with Hollywood Undead. That was way later in the band. I'm trying to remember. We did the Silver Bullet tour, which was our headliner, where we were supporting Pressure the Hinges. So that one was really, really exciting because that was, I think, the first headliner that I had been on. Mm-hmm. And that was at the end of 2006, maybe.
That's a big feeling, the headline. Then I bet that's just solidified everything. And it must have been in that time, 6 or 7, where I remember playing Cornerstone on main stage, and you, like, we both played main stage to get, like, I don't remember, like, to back to back in the afternoon on some, on, was that 2006 or 2007?
That would have been 2007,
but you,
I think.
You were there for that for sure.
Yeah.
But I remember, for whatever reason, I think we, I don't remember, but I do remember that. So that, you know, then you're in, was that your first Cornerstone? Or did you do two, you know, was that your first Cornerstone?
So
was main
my
stage?
First one, no, my first one was 2006, that summer. So I just really, I mean, I'd been in the band for, you know, 5 months or so. And I went and I camped at that Cornerstone. The rest of the band, they didn't want to camp, but I loved Cornerstone so much. Wow. I would drive from Colorado and go to Cornerstone. It was like my, you know, I was so excited. I got to play an encore stage at Cornerstone. So cool. And there was no pictures out of what I looked like. So I was able to go kind of incognito and talk to I just was making friends all over the place and talking to people about the new singer of Haste
the Prince Among the Paupers, the peasants out there.
It was pretty fun because I could get the genuine scoop, you know, mm-hmm. without the filter, but it was a ton of fun. I remember that Cornerstone being so exciting. And then main stage was like one of those wow moments where it's like, wow.
I don't like the experience, but it is a wow thing, but it's a super bizarre, that big giant space
it felt
with that catwalk
so
and all
awkward.
That. I did not like it.
Yeah, with the, I mean, even just having a wireless microphone made me feel like a phony.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah.
So next record after that then is pretty quickly to Dreamer.
Yeah.
So and do we have a personnel change yet?
Yes. So
and how is the band culture's changed by some, and you know, what has changed here with the band, the morale, the
nothing had quite changed, and actually this is brings up like a real bummer period of the band. We had asked Jason Barnes to leave the band. And that was a really, yeah, that was just a bummer. Cause, he wasn't a Christian anymore. And we were, you know, we were like all about this ministry thing. And I don't know if, you know, I don't think I would have made those same decisions today. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I haven't really talked to the other guys about this really, but I doubt that they would make the same decision as well. But at the time is what we thought we needed to do. And he was our main songwriter. You know, we went into Dreamer like without a lead guitar player, and Brennan wasn't comfortable playing guitar really even on the record. Like, I don't think he played hardly at all on that record. And we actually hired somebody to come in and play guitar on the record.
Wow, I didn't know that. I understood the Jason stuff when it was going down a little bit, because Dave and our drummer with Jason were best friends growing up, and they were in contact. And I know Jason had changed a lot in that period, but what was it from the inside? Was he changing over time, or did that come all of a sudden? What was that like? You know, was there that friction of having the swear jar, and then to the point where he's not a Christian to the degree you had to take action? Was that a process, or was that quick?
To me it felt quick, because I don't think I was as close to him as everybody else at the time. Because I mean, of course, I was the new guy, so everybody grew up together. I'm sure it was kind of more of a slow process. Anybody's journey like that is going to be over a long period.
But it wasn't conflictual, like, with what you were doing every day? Like, there wasn't conflict about spiritual matters through the year or something?
I think that there were some, like, maybe some moral things where we were like, you know, since we were so hardlined, and I think he was starting to loosen up about some of those things. And so that kind of made it evident. I don't want to say too much because I don't remember exactly what happened, but I do think that it was just kind of more of a slow thing, and it's crazy, and it's, man.
But he was more than just being like he was articulating an active non-faith more than just doing stuff that he shouldn't have been doing, though. It was an intellectual development for him, and he was vocal about it. Am I understanding that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I think, yeah, it came down to, I mean, I think he was getting really jaded about Christianity in general, which kind of was in conflict with us talking about Jesus on stage every night. And like, one of the things we'd say is, come talk to any of us. That was I remember that being one of the sticking points, which is like, what if somebody wants to come up to you and talk to you about God? Like, what are you going to say? Mm-hmm. It really sucks because, you know, I love Jason. And even like now, like that dude is so awesome. I don't know if you have talked to him in a long time, but he's just one of the coolest people. I would maybe take it back now.
I can see how you would have felt like you had no choice, given the, like, there's a mission that, sure, you know, propels and undergirds this. So it would seem like you have no choice in some way. But did he feel that way, or was he not understanding, I imagine, that, like, he would have had it otherwise?
Yeah, I think he would have stayed in the band. Mm-hmm. I think we just took everything so seriously. I mean, and, you know, when you're growing up trying to figure out how your faith plays into like what you do and how you live your life, like it's really easy to think that these lines are like so rigid and you can't cross them, or else you're like spitting in God's face. But yeah, I have a different picture of who God is now, and it's much broader than that. You know?
Yeah, I appreciate you sharing that, you know, that part of it. So thank you. And then that leads to, so then you're into Dreamer, and you actually have a, you know, tell me more about having a hired guitar player for that.
Yeah, so we did the record.
How did you write it?
So I wrote most of that record, and I'm not a great metal guitar player. So we just needed somebody who could riff, you know, and play really tight. And we did the record with Andreas Magnusson, and he was in that band Scarlet. And so we got the guitar player from Scarlet, Randy Vanderbilt, to play guitar. And that dude is a monster. He's so good at guitar. And he just, you know, I was in the studio every day, like, okay, here's the part. Here's how I'd play it. How would you play it? You know? And he'd play it perfectly first try. And
so he's basically the featured, all the cool featured guitar stuff on there is him.
Yeah.
Can you think of a song that shows that well?
Yeah, so
I can tell you what the Spotify listeners think. They like number two, Madman, of course.
Oh, yeah.
And then the last song have the most plays.
I want to say I played a lead line on Madman, but maybe I didn't. I don't remember. Anyway, Randy, he did this one solo. It's in, I got to look up what song it is. I don't remember the names of the songs anymore.
68, Madman, Haunting, Resolve, and Adultery.
Invoke Reform. That's the one. Invoke Reform.
Track 7, okay.
He played this like crazy metal solo that's like, I have no idea how you'd even play it. And we were like, let's just do like, because we wanted to make that song like kind of new metal. And we're like, let's just do like some weird, crazy guitar solo there. And he's like, what, like this? And I was like, yes, that. And he did it, and it's on the record, and it's pretty awesome.
Great. That's very cool. So then we go in all the way to 2010 to a new record. What happens there, member change wise and band culture wise?
Yeah, so so at this point we had a full pretty much everybody except for Mike Murphy had left.
And these are what, getting married? Things like, oh no, they're already married.
Brennan left because he was getting married, and Devin left earlier. I don't know his exact reason, but you know, he was getting married and just wanted to live a different life.
Just being grown up and ending that phase, basically took out a couple of members without any real conflict or drama. It just was where they were.
Yep. So right after Dreamer, we got Dave Kreisel on guitar, and then. After Devin left, we got Giuseppe Antonio Capolupo, the infamous.
Yeah, I remember him.
Amazing drummer. And then we got Scotty Whalen after Brennan left. So, I mean, just some incredible musicians, like unbelievable. Like these dudes can just play. I mean. Giuseppe's still going. He's playing for the Devil Wears Prada now, but he's one of the most entertaining drummers ever. And Scotty is just like one of those just unbelievable guitar players that has so much feel and style and can play pretty much anything he wants to. So Attack of the Wolf King was really fun. And also everybody in the band at this point, now Mike is the oldest. Mm-hmm. So we've switched all the older guys out for younger guys that are my age.
Yeah.
And so, with maybe a little less of that, rigid, Christianity.
Right. So that's so then at that point, it's like, it's only Mike left. Does the mission stuff still hold the same at that point?
Definitely. It's still held. But the lines were a little less hard. You know, we...
Swear jar's gone.
Swear jar's gone. We started drinking, I remember the night. It was Warped Tour. We ran out of water. At Warped Tour, they give you a case of water and a case of beer every day. You have to take them both because they need them gone. You don't have to drink the beer, but you have to at least take it out of the office. And so we were in a bandwagon. Our fridge was completely filled with High Life, and our cabinets were all filled with beer. And we ran out of water because that goes first. And we were in Florida, and it's hot, and we're all thirsty, and we're looking at this cold beer in the fridge. And we had already played at like 11 that day, and we were bored. And we were like, all right, guys, we need to make a vote. Should we start drinking? And we all, you know, we all drank on off days and stuff like that. And I think, honestly,
but that's what I said. What used to be no drink, then no drinking on tour, then drinking only on off days. And then here's this moment where, you know, you've filled your bus with the forbidden fruit.
Yes, exactly. And so we were like, we started talking about how, you know, because we'd go home from tour, or we'd have an off day, and we'd all go overboard and like drink way too much, and it'd get silly. And then we'd be like, wouldn't it be better if we just drank in moderation? And I think we still kind of had like a rule that it got broken a few times to not drink before we played. But
you're stepping it down, you know, weaning off of the rules.
Yeah.
Still pretty responsible. I mean, it's still like a 10-year process to get to that. So that's still quite conservative, I think. And were you still messaging Jesus from the stage in the same kind of ways?
Yeah, that never changed. Till the end of the band, we talked about it every night, and it was
cool.
Very cool thing.
So through the whole time of everything changing, even the new members and everything, I'm sure they came into the culture sharing the background and stuff for the most part, but they respected it at least. And the culture of Haste today held regardless of member changes to some degree. Like it just strikes me that it was like it wasn't super pendulum swingy. It was kind of this very conservative taper thing that, was mostly reasonable, it sounds like. And respect, the culture was able to navigate itself despite the players in the, you know, you made these, all this music of, from a how is it so, I'm stumbling over my words, but amazing that there's a few bands that can have, get down to one or zero original members, and the DNA keeps on going, the brand, the sound, the connections, like, that's a really beautiful thing, that different people are able to collaborate on the Haste the Day machine. I love it.
Yes, the Haste the Day machine. That's kind of how we felt a little bit. We felt like it was more of an organization by the end than it was necessarily just like a band and members. There was like a vision, overall vision that never changed. And that was to bring Jesus, you know, the love of Jesus to dark places in the world. And like where you might not find something loving and accepting, at a Hollywood Undead show or something, you know? Mm-hmm. And that was really cool to be a part of that and see, that stayed the same.
Do you know if it was a movie, the people back in the small town, they're saying, don't go out into the world, would have known that moment. See, Warped Tour pushed all that beer on you and made you, you know what I mean? Like that, the evil mainstream thing put you in a position where you eventually fell to temptation. Haste the Day culture keeps on rolling, and I'm trying to think of the other bands that have this kind of in their thing, but it's Mike Murphy, basically, is there. Yeah. He's the core, and so what about, how was Mike Murphy, like, what's special about him being the remaining member, and how does that play out for him? Like, what is that role for him? He becomes the oldest, you know?
Yeah, if you know Mike, he's the sweetest person. He's got a lot of vision, even though he probably wouldn't admit that. He just has a lot of vision and a lot of like, I don't know. We looked to him, although maybe I was driving the creative train. He was like, just kind of keeping it all together. And, I don't know. I didn't want to make any moves unless I got Mike to like, or unless Mike.
So
was,
he
like,
held the values. Like, he was the keeper of the principles and values that are the culture and DNA of Haste today.
Yeah, I think a lot of that kind of shifted down with him too. But he was just overall just like such a nice and lovable person that, like, I don't know. He just had great values and he's just awesome. But,
and he was meshed with the new guys and, you know, you make the Wolf King and everything. So how did that, at that point you clicked it more creatively and you have a whole band on the same page or something like that?
Yeah. So we kind of, we wrote that album. I remember we wrote that album in Indianapolis at my house, kind of all together, a lot of it on the computer, but, it felt like a new band musically, and Mike was doing a lot more singing. I don't know, we just all kind of felt like we had been playing music together for a really long time. And it was technically a new band, like, mm-hmm. at that point. And because, I mean, like, bass playing is, not in metalcore, you don't really hear the bass.
Not the
very
most
much.
Defining.
It's thing. Not the most defining thing, but somehow his bass playing was like defining.
It was,
like,
enough to keep it tethered.
Yeah, yeah. And he did this weird upstroke thing. Like, he played. You know how you alternate pick and you down, like, down and then up. Mm-hmm. He would go up and then down.
Oh, you mean his normal picking is reverso?
It's reversed. Yeah.
I don't like that.
He was able to do this like slap thing on the bass strings that like because he'd bring it just and just pop the strings that made it so punchy and tight, and like it was just awesome. And I've never been able to recreate that sound.
That is cool.
Yeah, pretty interesting,
cool quirk tidbit.
Yeah.
So on this album, if I'm looking at Spotify, track 8 pokes out with a bunch of plays, White as Snow. Why do you think that is?
So that one was our, I loved the Deftones and, you know, I really wanted to do something, that was just that like slow vibey, like when you listen to it, you're just totally wrapped up in the sound, kind of song. And, that was it. And you hear Mike's beautiful voice on that, on the verses there. And, that just kind of became like one of my favorite Haste the Day songs, actually. Definitely a totally different vibe than the rest of the records and all that stuff.
I've walked with the kings and I've marched to the pounding.
So what's wild is a lot has happened since 2007 to 2010. Like what we just got done talking through there seems like a long period, but that, what a transition period to get from, you know, 2007 when you get that call, or 2006 when you got the call, to 2010 and have Attack of the Wolf King out with a totally new band and a very updated band culture, at least, you know,
yeah.
at this point. So that's a crazy time to go through. And then coming out the other side of that, you've also experienced the, I don't know, collapse of the music business happened right out underneath that,
right.
too. So that, so the next phase is, how does Haste the Day finally reaches this new form, which is pretty powerful, but then times are tough and there's a, you know, what all happens in the next phase that to the wind down to the wherever we are today?
Yeah, so in Jimmy's episode, he talked about how hard working Haste the Day was, playing like 300 shows a year. Well, we never really stopped. I mean, we were like that straight up through to the end. And so all through these member changes, we are not stopping to like reform or anything. It's just like, all right, well, we've got a tour coming up. We got to find somebody. I mean, one of the members quit in the middle of a tour and we had to find his replacement overnight, you know? So it was just one of those things where it was like, we had, it was a crazy like 4 years of just like constant grind, constant writing, like writing, touring, writing, touring. Somebody leaves, find somebody else, new That's adjustment.
Crazy. Member turnover is like that. Like if somebody in a band gets replaced, their replacement is still now the most likely person to be replaced.
Yeah.
You know, and so, and when a band starts replacing members, they can become more likely to continue to replace members. But can that survive, and you know, how that's managed is always really fascinating. But when times are tough and numbers are down and markets are down, that's even tougher.
Yeah. And I remember it became really hard to make money. I mean, we never did anything outlandish. We toured in a 15 passenger van pretty much the entire time, save for like two tours. We Warped Tour, we had a bandwagon, and then on Scream the Prayer, we had a bus. That was the only time we had like a full bus. And after that, it was like, I remember feeling like, I was like, man, how are we going to make a living? Because we're doing these shows and, you know, hotels are expensive. And like, so we'd try with like, maybe let's try getting one hotel room. And so we'd all squeeze into one hotel room. We're like, that was horrible.
This is after 1,700 shows.
Yes.
And now you're trying to go down to one hotel room.
Yeah. And then I remember there was one tour where we were like, all right, we have to be able to make more money. Let's send a Facebook notification out there. We want to stay at your parents' house. We submit photos. And, you know, and that whole tour, we were staying. We went from like, you know, staying at hotels every night to staying at kids' houses, which honestly, the stories are just amazing.
It's an experience. From that tour. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
And that was the tour we also decided to break up on. That was, and actually, this is probably a little known fact. Me and Mike and Mark LaFay, our manager, we made a pact that if one of us was out, we're all out. So
Mark stayed. Mark was the active manager the whole time. So there's a real consistency to that. In addition to Mike Murphy, that's worth noting.
Yes. Yeah. And Mark LaFay is a band member. Like, as far as I'm concerned, he is the sixth member of Haste today. And so we said that, you know, like if he's out, then we're all out. Or if one of us is out, we're all out. And Mark called us and he was like, or maybe he emailed us. I can't remember. But I remember me and Mike, I think we read the email at the same time and we both looked at each other and we're like, it was a good run. And I think that was the end of 2010.
I don't know if I've ever heard that exact thing before first of all, it's rare that the person that you call the sixth band member, whatever it is, truly is that way and across a long time, whether it's a producer or a manager or a road worker or something. Sometimes you get those situations where it feels like family to that degree, but rarely does it last the whole time of a band. And the fact that one of a non-band member leaving the organization could terminate the organization, I don't know if I've heard that. That says a lot.
Yeah. I mean, at that time, it kind of felt like we were, I mean, I loved being in the band, and, you know, I'm super appreciative of every show we played, everything we did, but screaming every night is, I mean, I love writing music, but screaming every night is really hard, you know, and I was getting worn out. Like, I was just tired of losing my voice. I got bronchitis every winter, which I have not gotten bronchitis since the band broke up. But every year it would be horrible. And I just was sick of like not being able to talk most of the time. And, I was ready for a change. I didn't listen to any metal at the time anymore. I was like over it. I was getting really frustrated with the violence at shows. I mean, we played a show in Salt Lake City, and like, and I'd seen this a lot in Salt Lake City, where we'd have youth group kids there, and then these crews that are like hardcore crews or whatever, that and I'd just be seeing this jacked guy kicking an 11-year-old like in the head, and it's like, what planet is this okay on? Like, so that was wearing me down, and I think we were just all tired, you know, and we all knew that the band was I mean, me, Mike, and Mark particularly, but we all knew that the band was coming to an end at some point. We just didn't know who was going to pull the thread, you know.
Yeah, that's sad. And that was the hardest and darkest time probably for being able to earn, or it felt like, you know, it was just a hard time, the cycles of genres up and down and all the different factors. But so you maintained something and still did so, you know, it seems like everything stayed. The Jason thing was the hardest thing that it sounds like there, but other than that, the Haste Today community was able to do different things and reunions and stuff since, which is also seems like a healthy and positive thing.
Yeah. Yeah. We got together, in, was that 2014? To do Coward. And that was such a crazy fun experience. We had every member of the band on that album. I saw somebody on the Haste Today Facebook saying that he wanted to hear about Coward. So
that's interesting. So you were just like mixing and matching who's playing on what song and doing what thing.
Yeah, yeah. That's so really like sweet. The foundation of it was still the you know, me, Scotty, Giuseppe, Dave, and Mike, and then we had Brennan come in and do a bunch of vocals, and we had, you know, all the old members got together and wrote a song, and I got to produce the whole album, which was really fun.
Awesome.
Very difficult to organize an album when every member of the band lives in a different state, but we were able to make it happen.
That is really cool. A cool experience. Is there something on that album you think's coolest to feature? A song? I don't know that, you know, I don't know that all the tracks of that one, sorry.
Yeah, I mean one of my favorites, and I think it's a favorite, is Gnaw. It's the last track. And it's just, I mean, we put a breakdown in there that we added like towards the very, I think we wrote it the day we were recording drums, like to add just the most typical breakdown. Like, and we were like, okay, what are all the like generic things we can do in this breakdown to make it so typical? And it's, of course, it just slows down and gets slower and slower and slower. But it ended up being so cool and just so raw and powerful. The whole beginning of the song is just so fast and aggressive. And then it just gets so guttural and intense towards the end. It just, you know, we talk about that song a lot.
That's great. Well, Haste Today is a super cool culture, super cool fans. Your fans have been great, and they're all the time very interested. I've got, you know, some questions here from the Facebook group. One guy says he apologizes. I think this is funny. He apologizes. This is Paul Casper. Says he apologized for his sister who dropped you when you tried to crowd surf. and that was with Devil Wears Prada at the Napalm and Noise Tour in 2009. So, you know, I think that's weird, but are you mad at his sister still for dropping you? Is that her responsibility, and she failed at that?
I've thought about that every day. You know, being dropped, it really hurt my feelings. But, you know, whatever your sister's name is, I forgive her. Thanks for apologizing on her behalf.
That is funny. And some people are asking about your music that you do additionally, solo project stuff, and then, you know, you play with other bands, you play all the other instruments, you do composition and stuff like that. So tell us about like other musical endeavors that people don't know, and what your, you know, ongoing musical life is actually like.
Yeah. So, I kind of took a shift, maybe about 5 years ago, straight into music for film and television, and all kinds of media. So, I have a bunch of projects that are like geared mostly towards that, but I do a lot of instrumental cinematic music under my own name. I also have an indie project called Half Measure, that is, you know, it's kind of indie nostalgic, kind of singer songwritery stuff. So you can check that out as well. But yeah,
no,
most
no
of my,
bronchitis involved.
No bronchitis. Yeah. It's, I get requests every once in a while to like scream on people's albums, and I just can't do it because it would take so long to like build up that voice again
to get in shape.
And it just, it's tough. Yeah.
As a film and TV and stuff like that, are there composers, somebody's asked, you know, who's your favorite? Like, what's the style or films or TV shows that you think have the coolest music?
Yeah, that's a great question. One of my favorites, may he rest in peace, is Johan Johansson. He scored Arrival. You ever saw that movie?
Yeah, I know that one.
Incredible, incredible score. But I mean, he did Theory of Everything. He was just one of those Icelandic geniuses. It just writes the most, I don't know, it's music that just gets into my soul, I feel like. So that's one of them. Another Icelandic composer that I really love is Oliver Arnold's. I believe he scored Broadchurch, which is like a, it's on Netflix, I think, but it's like a British, mystery drama. But his music is incredible.
The, you know, I've always feel that that's interesting, that the genre and stuff of the, that we come from, and emotional music and emo and all these things are so expansive, and like it, they're very both epic and interpersonally emo, which is the things that film scores kind of do. So I do feel that there's a relation in there's a relation there as far as type of music goes, that even though the genres and the textures are quite different, there's some commonality there. And there may be some with Icelandic and Norwegian, all the Scandinavian stuff with their metal and their punk and their composition that somehow is somehow resonant in the same way. I think that's all interesting.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, because I've been thinking a lot about
Blindside.
Blindside. Ooh, yeah. So I've been thinking a lot about like what makes me when it comes to like the music that I create. Because I was a staff composer for a licensing company for the last 4 years. So I wrote 350 tracks in 4 years, which is just a lot. It's just a crazy amount of music. And so it's easy to kind of get lost in like who I am as a songwriter, because it's in all different genres, you know, whatever. And I'm no longer working for that company anymore, and I'm on my own, and I'm like thinking about what makes me. And really Tooth and Nail like has such a huge part of that, like that, the emo, like indie punk sound of early Tooth and Nail, like it imprinted on me in a big way. And like I hear, even if it's a totally different genre, I hear some of those like maybe chord progressions or influences in little like things that I write. So I just think that's interesting. It's definitely a part of me.
Yeah, that's really cool. A couple other tie-ins here that had to get mentioned, though. Is there anything else about being on the inside of As Cities Burn culture? Well, tell me about that one real
quick.
Ooh,
yeah. Oh, man. Nothing could be more different. Haste the Day culture versus As Cities Burn culture. But, oh, man, I just love those guys so much. And I did 3-4 tours with As Cities Burn. And it was just, man, it was fun. And that music, man, I have such massive respect for Cody as a songwriter. And he's written these songs that just like get to the core, you know, so quickly. And being able to play those songs was just incredible. But yeah, the culture is that of just fun. It's just, we did that Under Oath tour. It was, I think, Under Oath's farewell tour, like 2 weeks. And I don't think I've ever had as much fun on tour as I did in those 2 weeks.
Yeah. Yeah. They're fun culture, volatile band, not a conservative band or ever anything like that. I mean, Cody goes, I mean, I don't know what I'm saying, because Cody is so expressive that I've known Cody for a long time, and he's been many different ways.
Yeah.
He's been many different ways at different times, you know. So there's always something consistent about Cities Burn, always something fun. Music's always profound, every night. And then Cody's in, you know, different places at different times. And it's so, like, some of the most interesting people and interesting music possible. So I've always been, a big fan personally and musically of that band, even though they're right in our genre. The bottom line is, well, that no matter what, that cuts every night, whatever Cody's doing, it you know, you can't help but pay attention to it every single night. So
yes, absolutely. That's
pretty rare. Yeah,
he would change like from day to day in like how he'd play the song. Mm-hmm. So that was one of the fun things, is like, and then Aaron is just amazing at being able to follow where Cody's going. And like, so we'd play a song in kind of a totally different way from night to night. And it would like, I wonder what we're going to do here. You know, like he would drag something out, or we'd wait longer on a break, and you just kind of like, I'd look over at Aaron. So like Cody would do his thing. Aaron would like be able to follow that. And I would just watch Aaron.
Awesome. Yeah. That's awesome. That's special.
Yeah.
And so that's greatness to be around. And then also you've spent a lot of time with Aaron Sprinkle and done stuff with him too, in a small, you know, that's not a huge list of people who have been kind of under the hood with Sprinkle on stuff. So I'm curious your reflections there.
Yeah. I had the opportunity to work on a team with him at this licensing company. And first and foremost, that dude is just so great. He's like, I can't believe that he's the Aaron Sprinkle that like produced all those bands, because he doesn't have like an arrogant bone in his whole body. And he's one of the most talented people I've ever met. Mm-hmm. So like, and I've never walked away from a conversation with him without being like fully encouraged and like excited to go do stuff, you know?
Now, how different is that than Garth telling you sound like a drunk? You know what I mean? Like, isn't that so different?
It's a very, very different style. Garth had a style of like, I feel like he has a style of, you know, the authority, right? He's the, he's the, like, he made it to where he is, which he earned where he is. But you as a artist, you respect that and you listen to what he says. I've never quite worked with Aaron as a producer, but him as a person, he builds you up to be the best that you can be.
What else can you say about a person is, whenever you're around him, he makes you feel great.
Yeah.
And then there's output that's amazing. So what else could you say about a person if they're able to do that? And he you're right, that's how he produces, is at every moment you're feeling great. How pleasant. Yeah. And it's real, and it comes out good as a result of that. So as a process, that's the coolest. That's the coolest one. To not Absolutely. Have to have the authority figure producer.
Yeah. I mean, I've got to say, I maybe had one conversation with Garth because he scared the crap out of me. But like, I had, you know, I can call Aaron right now and we'll talk for a while, you know, and it's, he's just a really loving and awesome person.
Yeah. Very flexible as well. So, I mean, that's the, you know, I feel that you've been, your ability to be flexible has really contributed greatly to Haste the Day, its culture, the solid state. What a solid state band. Haste the Day, like, that's a solid state band if there ever was one, you know. There's lots of just things in there that just is very unique about solid state culture, and Tooth and Nail and Haste the Day. So it's like a nested thing, you know, the way I kind of see all of it. And your flexibility and being able to step in there, you know, you've made a lot of special memories for a lot of special people across time. And I think a lot of it is due to your cross domain flexibility and personality type, which I think is rare. But thank you for, you know, walking us through this and being a part of, you know, this is really fun. I got to talk to Mark LaFay now either way.
Yes, you do.
He texted me the other day and for sure I'm going to have an addendum to this where he just rattles off some stories or something.
Oh man, I could talk about Mark LaFay all day long. He became like one of my, after you know, after I joined the band, I moved in with him, and awesome. He became one of my best friends. That dude is incredible.
He's a lot of fun. And the what's preventing Haste today from playing is still an organization. It might play again. You're one of the, you know, the gatekeepers there. Jimmy Ryan said he doesn't have anything to do with it. So what would be possible for anybody to ever do from here?
I wish that I could really tell you. I'm not going to say it's impossible. I think that it could happen. I think there's just a lot of factors that would have to line up.
There's things that would have to line up. I mean, I'm sure it's complicated, not a simple thing like a dollar amount or a certain show or something like that. But it is, I mean, do you still see Haste today as a organization that continues to exist?
That's a good question.
Actively engage in anything?
I think it could exist. I don't personally think that it would need to cease to exist, but mm-hmm. at the same time,
it's at least stewarded. The Haste today does continue because people are listening to it every day, right? There's many people listening to Haste today all the time around the clock as we speak and experiencing Haste today.
Yeah, so I'm honestly amazed that there's still people who like care.
My view is it exists whether or not you participate with it, but you do kind of steward it, and it sounds like it's on the verge of being an operable organization that can, and then whether or not it engages in making media or playing shows. But I mean, yeah. It seems like Haste Today still, in my view, Haste Today does exist as
I think you're entity. So right. It continues to exist, mm-hmm. and if we want to play a part in that, then we can. Mm-hmm. It definitely interests me, but I have no definitive answers, and I wish I did.
I think that's totally fine, but just good to say it. I think that's encouraging, and plenty of time for who knows what'll happen. But I'm encouraged that these bands and the scene continue to, in some cases, gain momentum. These entities and cultures gain momentum, even if the band members are not active at the time. That's been a really cool thing to see people be able to come in and out of. It still feels collaborative and interactive in that way. So very cool.
I feel like Furnace Fest really brought a lot of that together again, mm-hmm. in a really cool way.
A lot of people were thinking you'd be on this one.
I don't have anything to tell you.
Well, thank you very much for, spending the time here. It worked out really great, and I was glad to be able to do these two episodes in a row, but I've really enjoyed it, and you've been a terrific follow-up to Jimmy. I mean, his episode was awesome, and I know this one's just totally awesome. People are going to love it.
Well, thank you so much for having me, man. This is great.
Cool. Thank you, Keech.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Label. My name is Cameron Case. I am from Livermore, Kentucky, and I've been listening to Labeled since 2018. A favorite song of mine is When Everything Means Nothing by Fit for a King. I say this because it helped me through a really dark time in my life. Labeled is produced by Matt Carter and Knucklebreaker Productions at Compound 3 Recordings. Editing and sound design by Seth Thompson. Editorial oversight by Jim Worthen and Adam Scatula. Brand and design direction by Joel Buckelman. Our production manager is Katie Franson. Executive producers Brandon Ebel and Matt Carter. Additional support from Marshall Frymoth, Tyson Paoletti, and Anna Mergesglocki. See you next time.